A very hearty good morning to all the attendees. At the outset, I welcome Sri S.K. Jaina sir, the senior manager in corporate communication group in Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited, Mumbai. On behalf of Denkanal Science Center, a unit of National Council of Science Museums, Ministry of Culture, Government of India, a hearty welcome to one and all. Friends, as you know, because of this pandemic, all our programs, almost all our programs are conducted online. And to make people aware, today we have organized a lecture on theme Nuclear Power and Environment, and which is the buzz of the world nowadays, environment. Of course, the program will be live streamed through our social media pages. Today we have with us Dr. S.K. Jaina. As I have already introduced him, Sri Jaina is looking after the public awareness activities of NPCIL. Through various public awareness activities, NPCIL is reaching to the general public on various aspects of nuclear power and students in particular. And NPCIL is associated with Denkanal Science Center, Denkanal. And let me tell you, we thank Jaina sir, because the nuclear power model in our campus, which is liked by most of the visitors. Jaina sir played a vital role in providing that 3D model to Denkanal Science Center. And as Jaina sir is from Odisha, we are regularly in talks with him, and if anything can be contributed from NPCIL, please have a look to that and consider give a priority to the Denkanal Science Center. And this lecture will be conducted online. So we have with us Jaina sir. Jaina sir had given several lectures, so he is associated with almost all our science centers under National Council of Science Museums. Last year also we have organized one lecture. It was highly appreciated by our online viewers. So today Jaina sir is with us. I won't take much time. Let us listen from Jaina sir, and in his lecture he'll give emphasis on nuclear power and the environment. How it affects and advantages, and nuclear power, I think it will be the ultimate energy source of power for human being, and it will always be, it should be used for the benefit of mankind. So now I request Jaina sir, please take over and enlighten us. Of course, it will reach to a larger section of the general public. It is live streamed, and many people can listen it later. Jaina sir, it's over to you. Now the platform is yours. Please enlighten us.
Thank you, sir. So nice of you. Good morning to everybody. And from now on, I will take care of this one. So the lecture is on nuclear power and environment. Okay. So like Raut sir has told, okay, I am working in the as a senior manager in Nuclear Power Corporation of India Limited, Bombay. Okay. This lecture is about environment and nuclear aspect. I will tell you some facts. Let me present. Start present. So now this lecture is nuclear power and environment. This lecture is on the umbrella of Azadi Ki Amrit Mahotsav, which is a very big activity which is decided by the government of India. And all the public awareness activities, including NCSM, Science Center, and other departments, they comes under this Azadi Ki Amrit Mahotsav up to next year, August. So this is also a part of this Azadi Ki Amrit Mahotsav. Now I will tell you what is nuclear power and environment. Roughly, if you see today, India is around the number 3 emitter of carbon dioxide in the whole world. Okay, so why? Because this is the data of Forbes, and it says that India emits somewhere around 2.48 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide in 2018 and 19. In 19 and 20, this carbon dioxide emission was less due to this pandemic. Okay, due to the closure of your vehicle movement, the closure of industry, that's why carbon dioxide emission is less. But in 2018, it was somewhere around 2.48 billion of metric tons of carbon dioxide. And how much persons has died? As per our Indian Council of Medical Research, that is ICMR, it says that in India, somewhere around 1.67 million deaths per year occurred in 2019 itself. Okay, so we were concerned about coronavirus from 2000 last year and this year, but in 2019 itself, 1.67 million deaths occurred in India due to the pollution effects. So that means the greenhouse gases, the pollution is a very big challenge compared to this coronavirus and other diseases what we know, because we are not aware of these data. So that's why we don't follow these things. We think that it is a very easy task, but actually this is a very big problem. Okay, now I will tell you how nuclear power and this pollution comes into picture. Basic idea is this. First thing is this land requirement of a nuclear power plant or a power plant. If you want electricity, how much land you require to establish this power plant? For a nuclear power plant, it is hardly 2 to 4 kilometers area, and it is comprising of the nuclear power plant as well as the colony. So it comes around 2 to 2.5 kilometers of area. Same case, if you go for a solar, it comes around 20 to 50 kilometers of area for 1000 megawatt plant. So it requires a small city. For a wind, it comes around 50 to this much of area. So 50 to 100 kilometers of area. So for a biomass plant, you require 4000 to 6000 kilometers area. So this is a very big area, which is concerned about in India, we are having very much of less space. Okay, so this area is a very big challenge. And in this case, this nuclear power plant is taking a less area compared to other power sources. Second thing is our fuel requirements. In a nuclear power plant, for a 1000 megawatt plant, you require hardly one truck load of fuel to operate it for full year. Full one year, you require one truck load. But in case of coal, it is 2000 trains. And in case of oil, it's super tankers, means 2 lakh tons of oil. So this is a very big fuel requirement compared to a nuclear power plant. So in a nuclear power plant, you require less fuel. So ultimately, one truck load of fuel is enough for your plant to run it. So it indirectly saves your transportation cost. Indirectly, it saves your carbon dioxide emissions due to your transportation and movement. So this is a very big requirement. Then, why I am saying about nuclear power? Nuclear power does not emit any obnoxious gases. Obnoxious gases means it does not emit any carbon dioxide, sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxides. So these are the gases, greenhouse gases, which pollute our environment. So by the operation of a nuclear power plant, these gases are not generated. So that's what indirectly you are not contributing for global warming or climate change. you are not contributing for acid rain, you are not responsible, or you are not contributing or adding to the ozone layer, which is present on the topmost part of our Earth's climate for formation. If you, our ozone layer is performed, that means if you find out holes in the ozone layer, as a result, the harmful rays which is emitted by the sun can enter to our atmosphere and it can directly come to us. So that's why you require the ozone layer. These greenhouse gases indirectly makes perforation in the ozone layer. So through nuclear power plant operation, you are not adding to the perforation. Similarly, through nuclear power plant operation, you are not doing any degradation of air quality. Air quality which is present is not degraded due to the operation of a nuclear power plant. That's because you are not emitting anything which is called a greenhouse gases. In NPCIL, we do a program that is called Environment Stewardship Program. It's a program of NPCIL which is basically related to the conservation of nature in and around our nuclear power plant sites. In and around our nuclear power plant sites means the nuclear power plant sites, which is present throughout India, is having a boundary wall of 1.5 kilometer radius from the center of the reactor. Center of the reactor is 1.5 kilometer radius ka area lete. So this area is called our exclusion zone. And from the center of the reactor up to 15 kilometers, your sterile zone is there. So this natural conservation is done on the 15 kilometer area of the nuclear power plant. 1.5 kilometer is your restricted area, others are your general public's area. So you take nature conservation on in and around our nuclear power plant. Through ESP, that is Environment Stewardship Program, we do a lot of conservation activities. We have formed nature clubs in our sites. All the sites are having nature clubs where our like-minded peoples, which are from the nature conservation agencies, they help and do a lot of activities. Now, through ESP, we do bird marathons. Marathons, it is not that running. Here, the term bird marathon means you are doing a survey of the nature or the species available on the nature through a long stretch, that is more than 5 kilometers of distance. And the transect means the line or the way where you go is more than 3 kilometers of radius. So this is called equivalent to a marathon running. So what they do is they go in the morning, they count the species, they point out the species, they identify the species, they note down the species through the agencies as well as our nest peoples, and they write down the number of species, number of birds spotted, number of counts, how many are approximately. So this is this activity which we do in our nuclear power plant. Every year from 2011, there is a site in Karnataka that is called Kaiga site. In Kaiga site, we are doing it from 2011. And Kaiga is in the Western Ghats, that is on the thick jungle of Western Ghats. And till today, we have noted down somewhere around 291 species of birds, different species of birds in Kaiga. Similarly, bird marathons we are doing in Norora site. Norora, it is in the Uttar Pradesh and nearer to Aligarh site. And in from 2010, we are doing the bird marathon in Norora site. And it is on the river bank of Ganga, River Ganga. So till today, we have spotted somewhere around 316 number of bird species in Norora. And Norora is a Ramsar site. In Ramsar site means the sites of natural importance, that is ecologically important. That's why it is called a Ramsar site. Next, there is a Kudumpulam site, which is in Tamil Nadu and nearer to our Kanyakumari. So we started a bird count because here we are doing not a bird marathon. Bird count means because the stretches are less than 3 kilometers. So that's why it is called a bird count. Okay. In Kudumpulam, what we are doing is from 2016 and till today we have found out that 113 number of bird species are present in and around our KKNPP site. So, what is the ideal of this species count or bird count? The idea of this species count or bird count is to find out what is the effect of an operation of a nuclear power plant on its environment. Okay? If the number of species is declining, or if a number of species is declining on a considerable manner, then we can say that there is an adverse effect of nuclear power on the environment. But what we have found till today is, and not just we are taking care or the taking help of our expert agencies like the Wildlife Institute of India, like this Bombay Natural History Society, like other NGOs which are based on the wildlife conservation. And with them, we have found out that the number of species are increasing. So that directly or indirectly says that there is a no adverse effect of operation of nuclear power plant on the environment. Similarly, there is a program of central government that is called Namami Ganga. Okay, everybody must be knowing this one. This was started by our Honorable Prime Minister Mr. Modi, and this Namami Ganga project says that the cleanness of Ganga through public-private partnership means we want to rectify this pollution of Ganga River. That is, we want to reduce it, we want to clean it. So that's why this program is called Namami Ganga. NPCIL sites, that's why this site, that Narora, is on the riverbank of Ganga Ji. Okay? So through Narora site, we are doing a lot of activity for Namami Ganga. We have associated with Wildlife Institute of India, which is a premier institute on environmental conservation, and it is under the Ministry of Environment and Forest. Through Wildlife Institute, we are doing a lot of activity at Narora for Namami Ganga. These activities are like, in Narora, we have established a turtle breeding center. Means we collect the eggs from River Ganga, then we kept the river these eggs in our turtle breeding center at an approximate or the approximate temperature which is same to the wild nature. And we are not the expert on this turtle. Let me tell you, we are not the expert on this turtle. We take the help of experts like Turtle Surveillance of India and Wildlife Institutes, who are the expert on this field. This experts helps us to do all the activities. Our volunteers also take part in that. What they do is they collect the egg from River Ganga banks, and they bring the eggs and put it on that our breeding center. They keep the temperature optimal for the growth of this egg. And once hatchlings comes, turtle neonates comes, they feed the acquired this wild type of foods, whatever is available on the wild, and they continuously monitor the growth of the turtle neonates. After that, a certain age or certain growth, these turtle neonates are re-released to the River Ganga, because turtle is a natural animal which cleans the river. Okay, so these two species, this species are bred here, and after breeding, this is the space where we are releasing the turtles to River Ganga again through the help of this wildlife as well as forest department of UP government. Similarly, through Namami Ganga, we do a lot of rescue and rehabilitation of other animals in like aquatic animals found in River Ganga. Because this photograph, it tells that in Gangetic River, in Ganga River, this Gangetic dolphins are there. Okay, these dolphins are found in Narora banks also. This Gangetic dolphin got entangled in the fisherman's net, so we rescued it and we bring it to our rescue and rehabilitation center. Then it was re-released after examination by the forest departments. Okay, so we do rescue and rehabilitation of this species, Gangetic dolphin. Then through for Namami Ganga, we do rescue and for muggers also, because in Ganga River at this location there are lots of muggers are there, gharials are there. And after that, we are doing a lot of public awareness activities or public sensitization activities for school students, what to be done and how you can contribute for cleanliness of Ganga. Similarly, a large number of activities are done for Namami Ganga, for fishermen, for general public, for leaders, for all these persons who are directly or indirectly related to River Ganga. So we do all these activities in association with Wildlife Institute of India. Similarly, through our ESP program, we do a lot of different activities at our sites, like annual bird marathon. Every day, every year we do bird marathons in the month of January to March, because January to March is the peak season where you can find out the winter migratory birds as well as your residence birds. So we do bird marathons every year in most of our sites. Then we have established butterfly gardens. Butterfly gardens means our reactor building is of 1.5 kilometer area, means this full area is called exclusion zone, and hardly out of this 1.5 kilometer area we use 20% for our construction of nuclear power plant. Other areas are left as it is, and we plant number of native species, plant species. Likewise, we have developed a butterfly garden in our Surat Kakrapar Atomic Power Plant, which is near to Surat. We have developed a butterfly garden in our Tarapur Atomic Power Plant, which is near to Bombay. Similarly, we have established a butterfly garden in our Kaiga Atomic Power Plant, which is in Karnataka. So what a butterfly garden is, it is a natural garden. It's not an enclosed garden. It's a natural garden. We plant those species of plants which are used for the butterflies, for nesting, for feeding, as well as for reproduction. So you are doing a natural environment which attracts the butterfly to this garden. So this is the concept of butterfly garden. We are having a butterfly garden, and if you visit the month of October or November to the Kaiga site, butterfly garden, if you swing your hand, you will find out that some 4 to 5 butterflies will be touching your hands. So similarly, we are having honeybee distributions. We make honeybee distributions to the general public or the villagers which do all these things. We do fish seedling release to the plants, to the nearby water bodies. What we do is we find out the number of or the particular species of fish, and we breed it through the help of our forest department. Then once they attend a certain size, we release to the natural environment. Like in Kaiga, we release to our Kadra Dam, which is nearby our plant. So this is this fish release photographs. And this is a mud flaps, artificial mud flat. In our Kudankulam plant, that is in Kanyakumari, we have created a natural mud flat. Means we have created an artificial mud flat, which is near to our this sea. So once sea is on a high tide, the water enters into your mud flat. And when it is on low side, the some water leaves again to the sea, but some water leaves stays in the mud flat. So it's an artificial mud flat created by us, and it is a natural environment for birds and butterflies. So ultimately, last year we have found out that a pair of these flamingos came to our mud flat. So ultimately, it takes a long time to develop the mud flat. It's not that 1 year we have developed the mud flat and another year the birds will come. It's not like that. You have to continuously monitor the development of the mud flat. You have to continuously see how the ecology is developing up. Then only the birds and butterflies, they come to the mud flats. So through ESP, we do a lot of awareness programs for general public also. We do a lot of programs for plastic eradication, lantana removal. Lantana is a species of wild this flower. It is an invasive species. Invasive species means if you put there, it can occupy the full forest and it will call all the native species of the plants. So if you cut the lantana flower also or lantana tree, it can again grow. You have to remove the roots of the lantana from the soil, then only this tree can be killed. Okay, and lantana is that species which suppresses all the species available on that forest. So lantana is to be what they call to be restricted on further growth. So that's why you require lantana removal in some cases. Then mangroves. Mangroves is a natural barrier for your tsunami type of things. And mangroves is the only tree which falls or which grows in the salt water, like the your sea water. So mangroves development or mangroves creates a natural barrier for your tsunami tackle. So we started reintroduction of mangroves in our Plum Plum plant and our Madras plant, which is on the seashore. So because mangroves degradation is generally due to your general public, so you cannot blame the general public how why they have cut the mangroves jungles. So you have to reintroduce the mangroves. So we do lots of mangrove plantation, and we do with the help of nature conservation agencies. Let me tell you. Through activity, this ESP, we are doing this bird marathon. We are have this butterfly garden, and then this is the your honeybee hive distribution to the general public, and your awareness program to the general public, and then we do lots of plantation with the students, school students. We call them to our plants, we call them to there, or we go to the schools and we distribute the natural or their species of plants which are available on that location. That is the natural species. We don't introduce here the invasive species. We introduce the natural species, and we do lots of plantation for them. Through activity, ESP activity, we do plantation in our plant also. This is the poster of paper bag make training. We do lots of training for paper bag, how to make bags out of paper so that it can be used for general public or in the market. So it is a what they call giving an opportunity to your local people for livelihood, as well as contributing for the protection of environment indirectly. So we do this type of activity with the help of the expert agencies. Okay, this is a poster competition for the turtle conservation or the National Turtle Conservation Day. So this small children were asked to make posters on turtle, and this is a conservation activity. Similarly, this is the activity where we do a rescue and rehabilitation of turtles from the river Ganga. So these things are there what we do in our ESPs. And the activities which we do in our ESP, we have come up with 4 coffee table books. These are the books which are written by our persons, and they deal on different subjects. This first book is our flying guest, which tells about the birds which comes to our plants and the number of species, their characters, their availability. This is our first coffee table book. Then we came with another coffee table book, that is the realm of flowers, the flower species which are found in and around our plants. Then we came with another coffee table book, that is the 7 Edens and 70 Fairies. There we have told about the butterflies which are available in our nuclear power plants, which are found in our nuclear power plant. Then another coffee table book we came, that is our flower of our flyers, our courtyard. This is the improved version of our flying guest. All these coffee table books, they are the product of somewhere around 3 to 4 years of data. Okay, you do research on 3 to 4 years continuously, monitor the birds pattern, the butterfly pattern, the flowers, then you come up with the coffee table books. So this is a hardcore research output which is done, and the result is this one. These coffee table books are highly appreciated by people from our eminent persons, and these coffee table books got awards also in different functions on national level, like Public Relations Society of India gave our flyers of our courtyard got first coffee table prize, and ABCI got first gold award for our flyers of our courtyard. So lot of awards are given to our coffee table books, means you are directly or indirectly recognizing the activities done for environment conservation by NPCI. So this is the concept of ESP, and this is the concept of environment as well as conservation. All you can contribute with the environment conservation apart from the operation of a nuclear power plant. Okay, this is the nuclear power plant available in India right now. We are having nuclear power plant coming up in Haryana. We are having a nuclear power plant at Narora. We are coming up with a nuclear power plant, and another is nearer to Indore, that is Bhilpur. Then already there is a nuclear power plant in Tarapur atomic power plant, and Maharashtra there is Jaitapur you are having Takrapar Atomic Power Plant near to Surat, and in Rajasthan, it is Rawalpindi Nuclear Power Plant near Kota. Similarly, in Karnataka, it is Kaiga, and in Tamil Nadu, there are two nuclear power plants are there. That is Madras Atomic Power Plant near to Madras, and Kanyakumari is in Kudankulam Nuclear Power Plant near to Kanyakumari. And future nuclear power plants is coming up at Powada, that is in Andhra Pradesh, which is nearer to Visakhapatnam. And another power plant is projected in Haripur, that is near Digha, that is West Bengal. So these are the nuclear power plants which are coming up and established nuclear power plant. So this is the basic structure of nuclear power plant in India right now. So I think I have covered the nuclear power plant and environment conservation topics. And with this, I conclude my lecture. If anybody is having questions, you can ask me. I'm always available. I will be trying to cover, I will try to answer your questions. Okay. Sir, I think I have covered the topics.
Thank you, Jena sir. Very nicely covered. May request our viewers, if you have any query, please unmute your mic and ask us. In chat box, we don't have, of course, this lecture is was live streamed in our social media pages. Definitely it will reach to a larger session. Jena sir has very nicely elaborated the things, nuclear power plant, and it doesn't produce no obnoxious gases by nuclear power plants setup. And even the effort which NPCIL is taking is really highly appreciable. From bird marathon till mudflat creation, rescue of dolphins, butterfly garden, and honeybee distribution center, and fish seedling release, and emphasis was given for plastic eradication, and Namami Gange project. Really, even NPCIL is contributing, and the aim of this lecture was just to make people aware, especially the students, so that they will come to know, and forever there is a NPCIL plan, people can visit, and they can see the surrounding, including a mangrove forest, even creation, and all these efforts for making our environment clean and green, NPCIL is doing a very good job. And before we disperse, on behalf of Dhenkanal Science Center, I wholeheartedly thank Jena sir. Being a holiday, he has spared his time and enlightened us. Thank you, Jena sir, and also I thank all our esteemed viewers. Please be in touch with us, or you can follow our social media pages, the upcoming programs, and I hope in future also we will come up with some other interesting lecture from Jena sir. Thank you all. We'll end this meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Jena sir. We'll end this meeting, and hope to see you soon in our upcoming events. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.